Welcome, everybody, and bring this hearing of the House Appropriations Subcommittee on Military Construction Veterans Affairs to order. And again, I welcome everyone to this morning's hearing on installations, environment, energy, and BRAC for fiscal year 2017. We have many questions. I should turn this on. Can you hear me? Okay. We have many questions to address concerning the 2017 budget request. It's notable that the military construction budget is down by more than 10% from fiscal year 2016 enacted levels. The budget request shows that combatant commanders' priorities and new mission sets were taken care of, but that seems to be at the expense of the service's basic needs. Projects planned in future years' defense program for FY17 dropped out. The impact of the Balanced Budget Act is still being felt as services attempt to include funding to restore projects that were cut to include quality of life projects. We want to discuss how force structure changes will affect the military construction budget in fiscal year 17 and beyond. Another high-profile issue is the European Reassurance Initiative, which our allies are very interested in, and the fiscal year 27 budget request includes $113.6 million for seven countries. Some of us did visit Europe this past summer and talk quite a bit about the reassurance initiative. Last week, we all have a keen interest in managing our facilities better in terms of requirements versus capacity, both overseas and in the U.S. The panel before us today has a lot of answers to these questions, I'm sure, but before I introduce our witnesses, I'd like to turn to the ranking member, Mr. Bishop, for any opening remarks he might like to offer at this time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and let me welcome all of our distinguished witnesses. I'm glad that today we're going to be able to talk about the President's 2017 military construction budget request, and we have the civilian leadership that can explain the priorities for military construction in each of the services. The folks before us have dealt with some big issues over the past few years. You've all dealt with sequestration, and you all have dealt with the budget caps mandated by the Budget Control Act. And you're once again functioning under another budget compromise passed by this body last year. At least hopefully we'll be functioning under that. I think each of you have done a great job in prioritizing the needs of your respective services and doing what's best for the warfighter. Each of your services has elected to invest in critical infrastructure and the needs of combatant commanders and the warfighter as opposed to quality of life facilities. In fact, I'm concerned that we're basically seeing quality of life projects disappear as you're forced to focus on other needs. Mr. Chairman, I remember saying 2 years ago that the Army's budget request was the lowest I'd ever seen. Now, fast forwarding to the 2017 request, this budget is the lowest I've ever seen. Changing gears, on another subject equally important is the DOD request to conduct another BRAC round in 2019. In 2005, Congress authorized a BRAC that ended up being far more expensive and expansive than we had been led to believe. And understand in 2004 it was known that the Department had 24% excess capacity, but in the 2005 BRAC, defense made reductions of only 3.4%. I understand that the 2005 BRAC was a reshaping BRAC, but a lot of money was spent to move things and, most importantly, move people. So I have concerns regarding another round of BRAC, but I also have concerns about maintaining infrastructure that we don't need because those dollars could go to more pressing needs. So, Mr. Chairman, I realize that these are very, very difficult issues for all of the members of Congress, and with that said, I'm glad for today's hearing so we can discuss these issues openly and look forward to a very vigorous discussion. So thank you for the opportunity to share my concerns, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop. Now I'd like to introduce our witnesses, and before I do, I believe we're going to vote somewhere between 9:50 and 10:05. And so we'll have to break briefly for that. I don't know how many votes we have. Just one vote. Well, then we can do it quickly. We'll vote and come back. So it shouldn't be a long delay. So our witnesses, the Honorable Pete Potechny, Acting Assistant Secretary of Defense for Energy Installations and Environment, the Honorable Catherine Hammack, Assistant Secretary of the Army for Installations, Energy and Environment, the Honorable Dennis McGinn, Assistant Secretary for the Navy for Energy Installations and Environment, and Ms. Miranda Ballantyne, Assistant Secretary of the Air Force Installations, Environment, and Energy. Thank you again for taking the time to be here and sharing your perspectives and expertise. Without objection, your written comments and statements will be entered in the official record. Due to the number of witnesses, I'd ask that each of you summarize your statement in about 5 minutes so that that can maximize the amount of time for dialogue and questions between the panel and the subcommittee members. So with that, we welcome you, and I guess we'll go from right to left. We'll start with Mr. Patechin. Oh, microphone, there you go.
Yes. Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, I appreciate the opportunity to be here and the honor to be here as well. By way of introduction, I am Pete Patechin. I'm currently the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Basing, and I'm performing the duties of the Assistant Secretary for Energy, Installations, and Environment. I appreciate my statement being in the record, and I'll summarize it very quickly. And my summary is essentially what you, Mr. Chairman, and Ranking Member Bishop just said. We are in a budget dilemma. We are making tough choices. We need BRAC in order to make those choices a little bit easier so that we're not spending money and resources better spent on our facilities that we do need and on readiness. And I don't know what much more I could say about that. I think you all recognize the situation we're in, and we surely do. Regarding the next BRAC round, the last one was expensive. The transformation focus of it did require that we spend a lot more money than we would otherwise. There is benefit in that. BRAC is a recapitalization engine to a certain extent. However, the focus of the next round will certainly be on reducing excess capacity, and that's what we're after. And so if the Congress does give us the authority for BRAC, we will be asking for a 19 round. This is the fifth time we're asking. I think we can use it in a way that Congress would be satisfied. However, in recognition of the concerns that you all have, we do want to enter into a dialogue about that request. I think we all appreciate the fact that the BRAC process works. It's effective, it's fair, it's transparent. So we don't want to do any harm to it, but if there are changes necessary, we will certainly like to talk to you about it. And having said all that, that concludes my remarks. Thank you.
Good morning, Chairman Dent and Ranking Member Bishop and other members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the Army's FY17 budget request. As you mentioned, our budget request is the lowest for the Army since 1993. The focus has been on combatant commanders' top priorities, as well as new directed missions such as cyber or unmanned aerial vehicle support. Our MILCON budget does include a request for $233 million for the National Guard, and that supports recapitalization of readiness centers. And according to the Readiness Center Transformation Master Plan, which was requested by the Senate Armed Services Committee, the readiness centers are experiencing critical shortfalls. And our FY17 request for the National Guard is a step toward addressing those shortfalls, but does not come close to meeting their entire request to recapitalize within the next 15 years. At the request of Congress as well, the National Commission on the Future of the Army also issued a report last year, and it includes recommendations on how the Army can free up funding for warfighting needs. The Commission specifically recommended, and I quote, "The Congress and the administration should look for cost savings opportunities in areas such as energy savings and a reduced inventory of military facilities." And so with the planned reduction in Army active duty forces to 450,000 by FY18, the Army will have an excess capacity averaging 21%. And if budget caps remain in place, the Army will need to further reduce the number of soldiers, and our excess capacity will only increase. The Army's budget request reflects our decision to continue to take risk in installation readiness, to focus our financial needs on soldier readiness. And the risk we are taking in sustainment results in an accumulation of deferred maintenance. The Army needs authorization to optimize installation capacity and free up funds for critical military needs. Last week, the Acting Secretary and Chief of Staff of the Army testified before the Senate Appropriations Committee that the Army must have a round of base realignment and closure authorized in FY17. BRAC is a proven, cost-effective means to reduce excess infrastructure. Without a BRAC, the Army continues to spend scarce resources to maintain unneeded infrastructure, hurting our highest military value installations. This is an unacceptable result for the Army and a disservice to American taxpayers. I look forward to working with you to shape the next round of BRAC. The Army's request supports efforts to implement energy cost savings and strengthen energy security on our installations. We are leading the federal government by implementing energy savings performance contracts. And since 2003, the Army has reduced our overall energy consumption by over 22%. Working with the private sector, we're increasing renewable energy projects, which we estimate will generate over $250 million in cost avoidance over the life of the projects. The Army manages 12 million acres of land on which more than 200 endangered species reside. There are many historic preservation requirements and land restoration needs. And so our FY17 environmental budget request of $1.05 billion enables the Army to manage these areas while meeting our cleanup requirements. This is critical to maintaining access to testing and training lands. The Army's top priority continues to be readiness. To meet our mission requirements, your Army requires ready and resilient installations to serve as platforms for readiness for our soldiers. I look forward to continuing to work with you to ensure they have the critical resources to defend the homeland. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today and for your continued support of Army soldiers, families, and civilians. I look forward to the opportunity to answer your questions.
Thank you, Mr. McGinn.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Bishop, members of the subcommittee, I'm pleased to appear before you today to provide an overview of the Department of the Navy's investment in its infrastructure, energy, and environmental programs. Navy Marine Corps installations and facilities are the platform to train and prepare our Marines and sailors to deploy ships, aircraft, and operational forces, and to support our military families. The infrastructure portfolio is vital to our operational forces and has a plant replacement value of nearly $230 billion. Of that, over $170 billion for Navy and $56 billion in Marine Corps. I'm confident that our very capable team works every day to efficiently manage this portfolio that enables that operational readiness. We thank Congress for passing the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2015, the National Defense Authorization Act for fiscal year 2016, and the Consolidated Appropriations Act of 2016. In fiscal year 17, the President's budget is requesting $11.9 billion, a 10.4% decrease from amounts appropriated in this fiscal year to operate, maintain, and recapitalize our infrastructures for installation. The Department's MILCON program request will invest $1.13 billion worldwide to support warfighting and modernization of our utilities and critical infrastructure. We appreciate congressional support of two additional MILCON projects for our Marine Corps last year. We continue to rely on the private sector as the primary source of family housing for our sailors, Marines, and families. Over 62,000 Navy and Marine Corps family housing units have been privatized through the Military Housing Privatization Initiative, and we are pleased with the continued high levels of satisfaction that are reported. To maximize support for warfighting readiness and capabilities, the President's fiscal year 17 budget request continues to carefully accept risk in facility sustainment, restoration, and modernization. In FY17 budget, the request is $1.9 billion to sustain infrastructure, which is a 16% reduction from last year. Navy and the Marine Corps have resourced FY17 facility sustainment at 70% and 74% respectively of the Department of Defense's facility sustainment model. I will note, though, over time, and if continued, this lack of sustainment will cause our facilities to deteriorate. The FY17 base operations support request of $7.6 billion is comparable to FY16. Due to overall budget constraints, base operations at Navy and Marine Corps installations are funded to the minimum acceptable standards necessary to continue mission essential services. We accept low service levels for most installation functions in order to maintain our commitment to warfighting readiness and operations, security, and family support programs and child development. The Department is committed to environmental compliance, stewardship, and responsible fiscal management that support mission readiness and sustainability, investing over $1 billion to achieve our statutory and stewardship goals. The Navy Energy Program has two central goals: enhancing Navy and Marine Corps combat capabilities and advancing energy security afloat and ashore. Partnering with other government agencies, academia, and the private sector, we strive to meet these goals with the same spirit of innovation that has marked our history. New ideas, delivering new capabilities in the face of new threats. Our naval forces offer us the capability to provide power and presence, to deter potential conflicts, to keep conflicts from escalating when they do happen, and to take the fight to our adversaries when necessary. Presence means being in the right place, not just at the right time, but all the time, and energy is key to achieving that objective. Using energy more efficiently allows us to go where we're needed, when we're needed, stay there, and deliver more firepower when needed. The Department of the Navy, in conclusion, continues to carefully and deliberately manage our portfolio to optimize mission readiness and to improve quality of life. The Department's FY17 request makes needed investments in our infrastructure and people, preserves access to training ranges, and promotes environmentally prudent and safe actions while ensuring energy resilience and security. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Bishop, for the opportunity to testify before you today.
Thank you, Mr. McGinn. Ms. Ballantyne.
Good morning, Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and esteemed members of the subcommittee. It is a true honor to be able to represent America's airmen before you today. You'll have to excuse my voice. I have a little bit of a cold. The bottom line is that the Air Force's installations are too big, too old, and too expensive to operate. 24 years of continuous combat, constrained fiscal environment really have taken their toll. In order to afford other Air Force priorities, our total FY17 PB facilities request this year at $8.3 billion is 4% lower than last year's request. That includes MILCON, FSRM, housing, BRAC, and environmental programs. We have prioritized MILCON over FSRM in FY17, requesting $1.8 billion in MILCON. That's actually a 14% increase over last year, and $2.9 billion in FSRM. That's down about 10% compared to last year. I expect our backlog of degraded facility requirements to grow. Our MILCON program is three-tiered, as you noted in your opening statements. First, we're ensuring that we're supporting all of the combatant commander's military construction requests. That's about 16% of our budget. Second, about 34% of our budget ensures that we have the infrastructure for bed down of new weapon systems as they come online. Third, about 40% of our MILCON budget allows us to begin to chip away at the very significant backlog of existing mission infrastructure recapitalization needs. Of the more than 500 top priority projects submitted by our major command commanders this year, we were only able to fund about 30. Finally, the Air Force needs another round of base realignment and closure. We simply must align our infrastructure to our operational needs. The Air Force has about 30% excess infrastructure capacity. Since BRAC 2005, the Air Force has thousands fewer personnel and hundreds fewer aircraft. yet we have not closed a single installation in the United States. Since the Gulf War, we've reduced combat-coded fighter squadrons from 134 to 55. That's a nearly 60% reduction. Yet all BRACs in that time period have only reduced U.S. bases by about 15%. BRAC is not easy, and Congress has expressed three very specific concerns that really come down to community impact, cost, and future mission needs. I'd like to address each very briefly from the Air Force perspective. First, communities. Air Force communities are some of our greatest partners and supporters. These communities are full of our neighbors and our friends. The Association of Defense Communities recently asked community leaders what they thought about BRAC. And 92% of those community leaders said that the status quo of hollowed out bases, reduced manning, and minimal investment is worse for their communities than BRAC. Without BRAC, the Air Force will be forced to continue to spread out our airmen and our aircraft, and many communities will continue to suffer from the economic detriment of hollowed out bases without the economic support that only BRAC legislation allows. Second, cost. Congress rightly wants to ensure that the savings of BRAC justify the costs, and we agree. And simply put, the results of previous BRAC efforts for the Air Force are really staggering. Previous rounds of BRAC combined saved the Air Force $2.9 billion each and every year. In other words, the PB request for this year would be almost $3 billion higher without the divestitures from prior BRAC rounds. And for the Air Force, they've had good returns on investment. Third, future mission needs. Some have questioned the wisdom of right-sizing infrastructure to our current force structure. And we have no intent to close infrastructure that may support future needs. And the analysis will be based on our military leaders' best judgment. Through five previous rounds of BRAC and numerous force structure changes, we've never dipped below a 20% excess infrastructure capacity. We've always left and we always will leave room for future maneuvering. While only BRAC brings substantial savings, the Air Force also leverages innovation wherever possible. Our community partnership programs, which many of your communities participate in, build win-win partnerships. Enhanced use leases and power purchase agreements save us money and give new life to underutilized real estate. We look holistically wherever we can. In closing, the Air Force had to make hard strategic choices during the formulation of this budget request, attempting to strike a balance between ready force for today, modern force for tomorrow, recovering from sequestration, and adjusting to budget restrictions, and we believe it's the right way ahead. Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and esteemed members of the committee, I ask for your full support of the Air Force's 17 requests, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Well, thank you. I guess we'll start with Mr. Patochny. The Department of Defense 2017 budget proposes $7.4 billion for military construction and family housing. The request is $1.1 billion, or 12% below the 16 enacted level. The majority of the decrease is in the military construction accounts, specifically $160 million decrease in Army construction, $642 million decrease in Navy and Marine Corps construction, and $187 million decrease in defense-wide construction. Can you explain to the committee how the department determined what projects or accounts were to be reduced and at what risk to other mission critical requirements?
When our budgets go down, we have to make the tough choices. This budget focused, as most of them do, as they all do, frankly, on mission bed downs, operations, health and safety, quality of life. And then within that framework are the trade-offs that the people at this table and our uniform leaders have to make in balancing how to allocate resources within that kind of a framework. I don't know how else to do it, and that's how we've been doing it. And I think the process we use is the best way to characterize it is, at least I'd like to think it this way, is it's informed decision-making. But it provides the services flexibility to deal with those individual dynamics. I don't know if that answers your question, but I have to answer in a general way because they can tell you the specifics.
Yeah, okay, and I guess anybody can chime in on this, but what areas do you, maybe anyone you can chime in, but what areas do you see the most risk with decreases in military construction budgets and the reductions to facilities, sustainment, restoration, and modernization? Can anybody?
I would say that the biggest risk that the Army is taking is in replacing our current infrastructure. We have over 52,000 buildings in poor or failing condition right now. And the majority of our budget is focused on combatant commander requirements and new missions, which for us is cyber or unmanned aerial aircraft. What that does not get after is a significant number of existing buildings out there that are failing. And that is the biggest challenge that we are facing in the Army.
I would concur with Secretary Hammack. Our program, MILCON, F-35, P-8, new ship deployment and home porting is in pretty decent shape. However, for other existing installation structures, that's where we're taking risk in MILCON.
Likewise for the Air Force. We have prioritized MILCON in our budget this year, allowing us to get after some of those mission-critical, worst-case existing mission infrastructure. But as I said, the backlog is very significant, and we're only able to fund about 30 of the 500 top priority projects that our MAGCOM commanders have submitted. We really are in a position of, it's not a question of whether infrastructure is going to fail, it's what's going to fail and when. And we have a very robust, sophisticated process to try to optimize the mission critical worst case first. But it's hard without a crystal ball to know exactly what's going to happen.
Thank you. And is there an ability for the department to catch up or restore reductions in military construction due to sequestration or reduced budget levels in the out years? Anybody want to take a stab at that one?
Well, Chairman Dunn, I welcome that question because the ability to catch up is called BRAC. The ability to catch up is the ability for us to close those facilities that have least military value so that we can focus our funds, focus our military construction, focus our sustainment on our most critical facilities.
Well, I got the message. It's all about BRAC. So, on European infrastructure consolidation, In your statement, Mr. Potocny, I think you mentioned after a one-time investment of approximately $800 million in military construction, implement two major base closures, eight minor site closures, and 16 realignment actions. Does the $800 million include the military construction projects requested for Germany in fiscal year 2017?
That's right.
Okay, and is there a corresponding operation and maintenance figure as well?
Yeah. Well, the total investment is 1.4. So, and almost $800 million of that was MILCON. But that's over the whole implementation of the EIC, okay. European infrastructure.
Thank you. And one other question, Mr. Potocny. In light of Russia's resurgent aggressiveness in Eastern Europe, there's been a growing concern amongst our allies about the risk of Russia utilizing its energy supplies as a strategic and political weapon, and we've all seen that. With respect to the Baltics, especially in Poland. I certainly share these concerns, as do a number of my colleagues. Is this risk being taken into consideration as DOD continues to develop and assess the energy plans for our U.S. installations and new military construction projects that are based within the European continent?
I believe so. Relating the question to what we've done to reduce our European infrastructure in general is we were really careful to make sure that our excess capacity is that capacity above what we need for current operations plus surge and fuel considerations are included in that. We also look pretty carefully at op plan requirements. And that's part of our contingency requirements to make sure that something that maybe isn't being used now is considered within that surge category, and again, that includes fuel issues.
And this is my final quick comment, and I want to go to Mr. Bishop. And are more energy security options, including U.S. sources, being considered in any of this analysis that you've done?
Yeah, I believe so. Yes, I can get you something more for the record if you'd like.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. This time, I'd like to recognize the ranking member, Mr. Bishop.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Farr is ranking on a subcommittee that will be meeting in just a few minutes. I'd like to, with your permission, defer and allow him to pursue his questions first, and then I'll come back on the next round.
Without objection, we recognize Mr. Farr.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bishop, for doing that. I'm sorry I'm going to have to cut out. I'm just going to give you my 2 cents worth, and all I need as a response is to all these questions is yes. First is just a suggestion. I'm probably more BRAC knowledgeable than almost any member of Congress because I've been so BRAC'd and largest military base ever closed. Threats of closing the Naval Postgraduate School of Defense Lanches, BRAC-ing Fort Hunter Liggett. And I've been through that process. I've been 22 years in Congress, and there isn't a day goes by that I don't deal with BRAC issues. And I've converted myself from being totally against BRAC to, even though I've been the victim of BRAC, I think it's absolutely, I agree with you. But I have just a suggestion. Why don't you convene an ad hoc committee of staff members and your folks to look at the language in which you bring it up? You always give the same language in your request for BRAC, and Congress just rejects it. I think if you presented it in a different way, in a very smarter ask, you might have a different reaction. And I just suggest you use your, we got a lot of technical people here that could help you with that. That may take some of the politics out of it.
You're going to get a yes to that one,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. And I want to ask you, Ms. Hammack, about this Monterey model. I think a lot of things, you can really take what's happened is here in Congress, we've created a defense community caucus, and we got defense communities aware of what military bases are about and what they can do with the municipal agreement models, and we've created a unexploded ordnance caucus. I'm co-chair of both of those, and I think now we got to go vote. We got to do everything at once around here. With the Monterey model, could you commit to the new extension of the Army agreement with Monterey and so that we can get that done and then get the year after that? It's just lingering, and I'd like you to do that as fast as possible.
To that, you get another yes.
Pardon me?
Yes, we will.
Yes. Well, I ask that you send your Mark Connor, your lawyer, and Army Budget Director Paul Kramer out to Monterey to meet with Colonel Fallinger. I mean, he's facing a lot of these things, and I just don't think from Washington perspective you see all the nuances of it. And I think you'd write a much better contract if they were on the ground and could see that. The other is, we have a provision in law, I guess, that doesn't allow housing to be built on National Guard bases. We have created in Camp Roberts, which is right next to Fort Hunter Liggett, a SATCOM operation there. And the commander of SATCOM says of the 14 installations around the world, this is the most vital one, geophysical one. It is a long way from any community around there. It's in the boonies. And what we thought is that perhaps you could possibly looking into the possibility of the geo bachelor quarters that could be built there. And I just wondered if you could investigate that and let me know what the options might be available to provide some housing for that operational facility there so they don't have to commute so far. And I know there's families and all that issues, but maybe are there other options? And lastly, before I go, because you have invested the money to create the state-of-the-art, probably the best in the United States, sort of the shoot house, a whole village of where you can go in and practice attacks. It's got churches and it's got everything. You can turn that village into any kind of scene you want, all electronically wired and everything, so you just put in the kind of background noises and languages that you want. And now there, in the fit-up is to add near there, is a new automated multi-purpose machine gun range. And it's in the fit-up, and if I ask in a letter, I'm violating the earmark things. But if you ask when there's money left over at the end of the year that you like that money to be spent on that range and move it up on the fit-up list from 2020, it might be very cost-effective.
Sir, when we look at Army priorities, we address the failing first. We address COCOM commanders' requirements, and we address new missions. And we do our best to prioritize according to that model. So unfortunately, we quite often do not have funding to do for advance.
No, I was suggesting at the end of the year, there may be some leftover funds because contracts didn't get obligated, and that surplus ends up being a surplus, and they usually come to the committee and ask us what our priorities are. We now turn it back to you, and I'm just suggesting if there's an opportunity, take a look at it. All right, my time is up, and I'm 13 seconds over.
That's pretty good for you, Mr. Farr. That's pretty good. We have how much time on the clock? About 11 minutes. I think what we'll do is we'll recognize Mr. Jolly, then we'll come back to the ranking member. And we have three votes. It's not one vote. So, Mr. Jolly, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll try to keep it brief. I've had the opportunity to talk with many of you, and I share your concerns. I don't understand why we're paying for cement we don't need when we've got war fighters who need to be better equipped. It's the bottom line. So I hope we can find a constructive way forward. Clearly, everybody's on the same page, but at the panel, I would say, though, Secretary Ballantyne, you said something probably more blunt than anybody else in your written testimony. The Air Force simply cannot afford to maintain our current infrastructure footprint. Simply cannot afford it. What's the reality of that? What does that mean?
Well, what it means is exactly what it says.
So what is the result of that, I suppose?
We're doing our best to prioritize the mission critical worst first, as Ms. Hammack said. So we're really going through each and every one of the projects that we know needs to happen, and there are thousands of them, 500 top priorities in this year alone, and really trying to prioritize which facilities are in the worst condition that really have to be recapitalized and are mission critical. And we try to prioritize those projects. We also try to prioritize the sustainment fund. That's kind of like changing the oil on your car.
Sure.
If you don't prioritize the sustainment, you're going to create problems down the road. So we try to keep that as full as possible. Even this year, we're funding that only to 77%, which is lower than we've been.
And your written testimony is Air Force excess capacity is 30%, or will be 30% by FY19. Is that right?
It's about 30% excess infrastructure capacity. We've run the numbers a number of different ways, looking at various force structures, and it ranges anywhere from 28 to 34, depending on which force structure you use. So we round it out to about 30%.
Thank you. And Ms. Hammack, you used the term installation readiness. Is that referring to what's the lay interpretation of installation readiness?
Installation readiness means that we support soldiers so that they are ready to deploy. So installation readiness affects training land. Installation readiness affects the buildings that we use to do pre-deployment training. Installation readiness affects it's the energy that is available to ensure that we can deploy under a wide range of circumstances.
And that's where you have insufficient resources to address installation readiness needs.
We say there is a risk. Okay. And as Secretary Ballantyne said, we do our best to maintain those critical infrastructure first, but simply there is not enough money across the budget to maintain all the facilities that we have.
Okay. And you and I had the opportunity to talk about some of the results of the European infrastructure consolidation. I know that was mentioned earlier. You have a little more flexibility in addressing overseas installations. Can you share some real-life examples of the success of that and why that might provide some encouragement for CONUS BRAC, if you will?
Yes, sir, and thank you for that question, Rep. Jolly. You know, when we look at the European infrastructure consolidation for the Army between our restoration and modernization funding and our MILCON funding through 2022, we're going to spend about $300 million. What we're going to return is $170 million in annual reoccurring savings. And that's less than a two-year return on investment. That means that we are returning to Germany those facilities that we no longer have a mission need for. What we're going to end up is not zero excess infrastructure, but around 7%. And around 7% is where we think we can balance surge requirements, we can balance modification to mission requirements, and that's what we'd like to do in the United States. And the Army right now is anywhere between 18 and 21% excess capacity. We will never get to zero, but there's plenty of room for us to reduce excess infrastructure, reduce those costs so that we can focus on warfighter requirements.
And the European infrastructure consolidation, you'd consider a successful construct, if you will.
Absolutely.
Right. Do you have a comment as well, sir?
Yeah, I'll chime in from the Air Force perspective, where the bulk of the actions are. We have 9 actions, going to cost us about $1.1 billion, and we'll save probably close to $300 million each and every year. But what's really key is the process worked. It worked very effectively, and we are not reducing our warfighting capabilities at all. We're just doing it more effectively.
It's a good model.
It's a good model.
All right. Thank you.
If I could add to that, though, we're closing Mildenhall. That's huge. Mm-hmm. In Europe.
All right.
We would not be able to close a base here because we need Brackwell.
Sure.
We have about how much time left?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jolly. We have 6.5 minutes left in the vote. I'm going to recognize Mr. Sanford. I would recommend that all you go up to vote. I'll stay as long as we can. So I'd recognize Mr. Sanford, Mr. Bishop, for as long as he's wants to speak. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Secretary Hammock, the Army's estimate of excess capacity across the enterprise is 160 million square feet. At the end strength of 490,000 active component and 170 million square feet at an end strength of 450,000. To deal with this problem, the Army Management Action Group approved a strategy of right-sizing within installations to reduce costs. First, can you tell me how much it costs to maintain this infrastructure? Next, can you explain why the Army Management Action Group, what the Action Group has done to control costs? How bad would your capacity problem get if the Army is forced to go below 450,000. And for Secretary Ballantyne, the Air Force's estimate of excess capacity is roughly 30%, while aircraft and manpower has steadily decreased. So the Air Force has drawn down aircraft and personnel without reducing infrastructure. How much does it cost the Air Force to maintain excess capacity? Has the Air Force taken steps like the Army to address it?
Thank you, Representative Bishop.
And if you would abbreviate your answers, I know we'd like to make the vote, but
okay. Well, the strategy for right-sizing within the installation means that we consolidate personnel into the best quality buildings, and we are able to shut down those buildings, which means you modify the temperature controls, you don't have lights that you have to manage, and you put them pretty much in cold storage. So we have identified that there's approximately 40 million square feet that we could put into cold storage through those efforts. And since it costs us about $3 a square foot to maintain buildings that are underutilized, we think that 40 million square feet could be about $140 million annual savings. Now, it's going to take us a while to consolidate into the best buildings. And so we have issued a executive order for every garrison commander and senior mission commander to develop an installation reduction plan addressing excess within their installations.
Thank you. Ms. Ballantyne.
Thank you. So it's slightly different for the Air Force. Since the early 90s, at the beginning of the Gulf War, we've reduced our aircraft force structure by about 60% in terms of combat-coded fighter squadrons, and our personnel by about 30%. Our infrastructure base closures have only been about 15%. So when we look at consolidating, it's not just a matter of consolidating people into buildings. A lot of our excess infrastructure has to do with iron, with actual aircraft. So we have extra parking spaces, excess hangar space, excess maintenance space. And really the only way that we can get at that excess is to consolidate by closing bases entirely. And that's really where the big dollar savings come. Now that said, we have very robust programs in energy savings and enhanced use leases to get after some of the underutilized real estate on our bases, through our community partnerships programs, and those programs are paying very good dividends for us, but just nowhere to the tune of what we can do if we can actually close a base.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
What we'll do is this Well, this meeting will be in, this subcommittee meeting will be in recess to the call of the chair, which should probably be about half an hour. We're in recess. We have 2:40.
2:40.
2:40 to go. Thank you all for returning. We'd like to bring the order this meeting of the Subcommittee on Military Construction, Veterans Affairs. For a variety of reasons, it's a crazy morning. Mr. Bishop will not be able to return. Ms. Lee will be here till 5 of, and then that's when the hearing will have to end. So with that, I'd like to recognize the gentlelady from California, Ms. Lee, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you all again for being here and for your service. Wanted to mention a couple things. First of all, just like to note that during my tenure with my former boss, former chair of the Armed Services Committee, Ron Dellums, we went through a BRAC process. Then I actually went to the legislature, and along with Congressman Farr, we were the point people on BRAC from the state of California. And we went through, in my district, I think it was 5 bases that were closed. And so as part of the transition process, we worked to ensure that the local community affected by BRAC had the support that it needed to adjust to the closing of the bases. But we still have a lot of work to do, and this goes back years. So let me just ask you a couple questions. First of all, where Alameda Point is, the Naval Air Station. We took title to about 1,400 acres of land and water from the Navy. This was in June of 2013, even though the bases closed 10, 15 years before. The VA took about 624 acres of land from the Navy in November 2014 for the construction of the new VA outpatient clinic and cemetery. Good example of how properly repurposed former military installations can really set a standard for the rest of the country. I know the Navy's been conducting environmental remediation efforts in Alameda, at Alameda Point, including the removal of toxic substances from below the ground and creating grassland and wetlands. So while the department is investing more than $1 billion, I guess it's in fiscal 2017 across the agency with regard to environmental compliance, this number represents a 2.3% decrease in funding from 2016 levels. So I want to hear about the Navy's next steps as it relates to environmental remediation throughout the country and specifically in Alameda Point and your long-term environmental sustainability and stewardship efforts, because with this kind of a decrease, of course, I know all of us are a bit concerned about more delays.
Thank you, Rep. Lee. We are taking great steps, continuing to take great steps. You mentioned the closure of those 5 major bases in the Bay Area. Since 1991, we've had 5 major BRAC actions that the Navy has participated in. 94% of the total acreage has been returned or turned over for economic development activities, including those that you mentioned at Alameda. We anticipate that by another 6 years, the remaining 11,600 acres will be turned over for across the country. Specifically for our environmental remediation program, we have a prioritization matrix that decides where are the greatest issues and where can we put the money for remediation that will accelerate to the maximum extent possible the turnover of that land to economic development activities. So I can provide you more of a detailed response specifically on Alameda or across our whole environmental remediation related to BRAC program.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to get both because, of course, naturally with the 2.3% decrease, all of us are quite concerned. Could I ask one more question for our ranking member? Let me ask with regard to the budget driving the request for the new round of BRAC, is this the drawdown of forces? Is that the reason for that? And how complicated is this new BRAC process going to be? This budget calls for an entire new round. So what's really driving that?
Okay, so the drawdown forces makes the requirement for BRAC even more important. Less forces means less bases are required to house them and for them to operate from. But the requirement for us, and I call it a requirement for us to devote the maximum resources to readiness and sustainability, and that includes our built infrastructure, is critical. And so to spend money on facilities that we don't need really doesn't make any sense to any of us, and I believe the Congress as well. And the BRAC process is the only way to get at it in a holistic, fair, transparent way.
And so how about the European infrastructure consolidation? Does that function as the training effort for BRAC and
yes, ma'am,
the U.S.
sort of standard? That's a good way to put it. We did model it after the BRAC process. We have a statute, but we used criteria and used basically the same kind of analysis, the same kind of decision process, and we did that on purpose. Both as BRAC practice, as you mentioned, but training, but also because it's a good way to look at your infrastructure.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I'd like to at this time recognize the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Joyce, for 5 minutes.
thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I would like to start off with Ms. Hammack. There's a lot of discussion about the process, the BRAC process. There are many of us who don't have active bases or any facilities in our district, but we do have National Guard and reserve facilities. How would they be impacted by BRAC?
Thank you for the question, Representative Joyce.
And I'm sorry if somebody asked that before. I know.
No, that question has not been asked, but in BRAC 2005, the reserve component, both Guard and Army Reserve, participated in BRAC for consolidation benefits. And so in some of our best ones, you might have two Guard units, one reserve unit, and perhaps Fish and Wildlife Service that merged together into one federal facility with Guard and Reserve units utilizing the facility on weekends and Fish and Wildlife using it on weekdays. What it meant is the total federal cost of operations went down. It also meant that each of the divisions had more capabilities. They had better training classrooms. They had better break rooms. They had better meeting rooms and gathering rooms. They had better parking facilities. So it was a net benefit to all. Based upon the experience in BRAC 2005, the Guard and Reserve are very eager for the next round of BRAC to help them benefit by adjusting to today's demographics from the demographics of the 1940s and 1950s, where many of them were stood up and their facilities were built. And so the Guard and Reserve would benefit from consolidation. The Guard and Reserve would benefit from facilities built to today's standards, to today's mission requirements, to accommodate the current missions that they have, which are very different from some of the past.
Well, thank you. In your written testimony, you state that in response to risks posed to our nation's vulnerable energy grid, the Army is improving the resiliency of installations through the use of on-base renewable sources of energy. You indicate that resilient Army installations are those that can withstand security threats such as power interruptions, cyber attacks, or natural disasters. The style of warfare obviously is changing. On top of needing to maintain a strong physical military presence, there are new challenges brought on by the threat of cyber or energy attacks. Can you tell us more about how these on-base renewable energy sources will enhance the resiliency of Army installations?
Absolutely. We're partnering with the private sector and leveraging private sector capital to install renewable energy systems on Army bases so that should there be a disruption with the national grid, the base is still able to operate. And in last calendar year, we demonstrated that at Fort Drum in upstate New York. And Fort Drum was a base that was impacted by ice storms and weather events that took down the national grid. And the base was out of power for over a week. During that time, they tried to run on backup generators, but then you had fuel that was running low. The private sector came in and built a biomass facility that is utilizing clippings from the timber industry and from forest thinning to power the facility. They have 3 months worth of fuel on or very close to the base. And this winter, we demonstrated that they are able to disconnect from the grid and still power all services on base. That is a resilient base that's there to meet mission and deployment requirements of the active duty. It's there also to serve the community that is looking for a light in the darkness when the grid might go down. So that's what we mean by resilient bases with renewable energy.
That sounds like a great thing. How about the cyber threat problems? What have you done to address those?
We are working hard on the cyber threat, and certainly when you are able to disconnect and isolate, that makes your grid less vulnerable. Certainly the cyber threat is constantly changing. Mm-hmm. And so that's something that we are working very closely with the cyber community to try and enhance our resiliency by hardening our systems.
Great, thank you. I have no further questions at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Joyce. At this time, I'd like to recognize the gentlelady from Alabama, Ms. Roby, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you all for being here today. And I have just a few issues that I want to address. Secretary Ballantyne, I want to talk about mold for a minute. I have seen multiple reports recently regarding the presence of the black mold at Al Udeid. But recently I received a text message from a friend of mine who is actually there right now. And he told me, he said, these reports are, they're not made up, they're real. And it's really bad. And it's not just in the bathroom facilities. There's mold in the curtains. I mean, it's really just gross. And I know that our National Guard members have been exposed to this unhealthy environment. I've read the internal document that talks about the stages of how this is going to be addressed, but clearly it's not being addressed quickly enough. So I wanted to hear from you directly about your thoughts on this, and what can I tell my friend who's there? And he's only there for a short time, but as he stated in his text message, he's more concerned about those that are there for the duration, and so it's very concerning.
Thank you, I appreciate it. I just came back actually from the AOR myself this fall, and we did talk some about the mold issue as well as a range of challenges that we face with expeditionary facilities that really have outlived their life. So the chief and the secretary have asked AFSCENT to continue and step up the pace of the program to maintain. We've changed the custodial contract there, and that has already started to show some benefits, increased government oversight of the contract, so maintain is step one. Then replace, repair, and actually start to move people into more permanent facilities. So this summer, 20 permanent facilities will be completed, which will be able to house 2,500 people. Making that transition is a very important piece because these expeditionary style of latrines and lodging in this type of environment with the heat and the humidity, you don't tend to think of Al Udeid as a humid type of place, but being so close to the water, it tends to be very humid. Heat, humidity, and expeditionary facilities tends to make mold a pernicious problem.
Sure. Well, I wanted to bring attention to it today, and I thought it was appropriate. My hope is that you will continue to provide us any updates as it relates to those efforts, and I would appreciate that. I want to move real quickly to the air tower at Maxwell Gunner Air Force Base. It's the home of Air University, you know, and other very important missions, and we not only have the 908 there, but we also, a lot of VIPs fly into Maxwell on a routine basis. Now, I have had the opportunity now twice to climb up in this tower, and since we're offering invitations, I'm sure that the leadership there would love to have you come climb up in the tower. It's a frightening experience, to say the least, and when you get up there, you can't even see one of the runways. It's obstructed by a building. And then also what's fascinating about this tower is the escape mechanism in case of a fire. It is a cable that runs to the roof of a nearby building and basically a tarp of sorts that you would put your body in and glide to the roof of the adjacent building. So obviously very antiquated, but causes problems with the with not being able to see the runway. So we had language in the last Milcon VA appropriations bill that addressed this specifically and encouraged the Air Force that these towers are very important national security assets, and that you should the Air Force should maintain them in a manner that will ensure that their role of protecting the U.S. national security interests. So I would love to hear an update about where we are with this tower and others that are in need to be replaced.
Yes, ma'am, and I think you just gave a perfect example as an answer to Rep. Jolly's question earlier about can we describe some of the risk that comes with these reduced budgets, and that's a perfect example. The good news on that particular tower is it is in the FYDP right now. It's in the FY19 program, and we do have a range of existing air traffic control towers in our list of projects that really need to happen.
Okay, well, please, again, keep me posted about where we stand on this tower. It's just, and if you're ever down our way, let me know, and I'll make sure you get to climb up the tower.
Thank you, I will.
Okay. Thank you, Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Roby. I'd like to recognize Ms. Lee. She has a few questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me ask you, Ms. Hammock, with regard to the Oakland Army Base remediation project. Our office has been receiving periodic updates. The remediation contract, it was awarded to Engineering Remediation Resources Group, and the tasks related to the cleanup. I want to know if they are ahead of schedule, on schedule, any updates on this project, because it's taken a long time, and just what efforts are you taking with regard to ensuring environmental sustainability at the Oakland Army Base? And then for all of our witnesses here, and you don't have to respond today, but if we can get the information with regard to the participation of minority and women-owned contractors, how many of these businesses do your branches work with? And I'd like to see if we can get that information disaggregated for this committee, because you have pretty significant budgets with contracting opportunities, and I want to make sure that those opportunities are going to small businesses, minority and women-owned businesses as required. Thank you.
Thank you, Ripley. Certainly the Oakland Army Base, the work there is progressing. We anticipate that the majority of the cleanup will be done in June of this year. And then after that, the transfer really depends upon the state of California and their review of their work, what that was done, and their processing. But the work is on target, it's on schedule, and we hope that it will be able to be transferred within the calendar year, if not early next.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Chairman. And again, these bases closed, gosh, way early 90s? Early to mid 90s, and we still are in the process of remediation, cleanup, and to this point, we still haven't been able to move forward to fully recover and redevelop the bases.
If I can comment on that, in the prior BRAC rounds, there had not been an effort by the services to clean up bases while those bases were operational. Very little efforts. What is very reassuring is that the bases closed in BRAC 2005 had very little environmental cleanup because we started getting after it while the base was operational. So really it is some of the older BRAC rounds that have the biggest challenges for cleanup.
Thank you. Lessons learned. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ranking Member.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. At this time, I'd like to recognize the gentleman from Nebraska, Mr. Fortenberry, the Vice Chair of the Subcommittee, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. Pleasure to see you all. You may remember last year when you were here, I held up a little sign, and Secretary Ballantyne, I was reading a little bit of your bio here. You have a degree in psychology. So what would you rather hear, base realignment and closure or military installation savings commission? What is more inviting? What is more attractive? I am trying to get everyone to shift the rhetorical construct of this whole endeavor, which we, most of us anyway, agree with. When you testify that we've got 30% excess inventory in the Air Force, we're asking you to do more with less and yet carry forward older, antiquated things that are no longer viable. That's not fair to you. It's not fair to the taxpayer either. However, because communities have so integrated and also been so supportive of the various military installations around the country, we look for off-ramps when it's necessary because of our national defense needs, but also to assist the community in that transition. Starting with language that is less ominous and is more partnering and inviting would be not just a suggestion. I plead with you to do this because this is, I think, a better way to endure the psychological trauma. Now, I'm not a trained psychologist.
Call Frank Luntz.
That's true. In that regard, it is a serious comment in the sense that I want us to try to continue to partner constructively in this regard so that we are assisting you with this process, that it is a certain times a painful and difficult process, but nonetheless can be creatively achieved through community input, as our good friend Congressman Farr has spearheaded and continues to talk about, the Monterey model, whereby certain communities who are situated can take on certain services that are not integral to your mission, expanding on that. And then when there is simply excess inventory, carving it off or out when possible versus you get to close and you get to stay open, again, is a better framework, I think, in pursuing this and maybe get us there faster. One quick question for you, Madam Secretary, is the issue of the Offutt Air Force runway. So we have a critical piece of national security infrastructure with Strategic Command and Offutt co-located in a symbiotic relationship. We have a runway that air crews have to literally walk down to make sure there's no loose piece of concrete that could damage one of your planes. The DOD is committed to doing this project. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. At the same time, I and others have the obligation to continue to have reasoned oversight of this and, again, to partner with you. So in that regard, we have put together a working task force of our delegation. We meet regularly with the governor as well to look at the issues of seamless transition for you. For instance, the guard base in Lincoln, 50 miles down the road, has enough capacity to support housing of your operations in the meanwhile. There's some consideration that the Omaha airport, it's called Epley, which is in very close proximity, could be some kind of staging in case of an emergency. All of this is to say that the broader project of a full replacement would be the ideal, but I recognize there's a lot of variables that go into that consideration. It's not just money, but also the downtime. So can you comment on both of these dynamics of changing the way in which we are rhetorically constructing this need to reduce your excess inventory, assisting communities in the transition, and the specifics of Offutt?
Sure, and I think you said it all very well. So let's take the first one first. From my perspective, absolutely, we ought to be talking about partnering with communities. We ought to be looking at opportunities for community benefit. Our community partnership program has been very successful. Our enhanced use lease program has been very successful in looking for ways to leverage underutilized real estate. Now that said, we still absolutely are going to need some closures. It's really got to be both and, from my perspective, not either or. So there's a lot we can do to partner with communities, leverage the Monterey model, leverage what we've learned through our community partnerships programs, leverage enhanced use leases, and at the end of the day, we simply are going to have to close some bases to really get those dollar savings. So it's a both and, from my perspective, speaking of language, not an either or. On the runway, you're absolutely right, and you said it exactly right, that it's not if, it's a matter of when. We're looking at options now and really balancing cost with downtime, how long can the mission withstand the runway being closed. And I really appreciate your offer of partnership and the pulling together of your commission to help us work through those issues. So I'll ensure that our folks are well connected with that.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Fortenberry. I guess we'll move into the second round of questioning. And I'll yield to Mr. Bishop, and then I'll come back to myself, because I know he's been the he had an abbreviated first round. So, Mr. Bishop, you recognize.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to touch on the Asia-Pacific strategy and the Guam realignment of the Marines, Mr. McGuinn. Secretary, can you give me an update on the Department's efforts to pivot to the Asia-Pacific region in terms of facilities, specifically in Guam and Japan? And I know there have been numerous issues with the local politicians and the general public in that area. In fact, they've brought that conversation to Washington, to my office, several times. So I know that I'd like to know, as we're seeing some concrete movement on the project, what have been some of the issues that have surfaced, and how and have they been adequately dealt with?
Thank you, Mr. Bishop. Two parts. Basically, the relocation of Marines from Okinawa to Guam is proceeding as planned. We've started construction activities, and that is going well. As you may know, the initial operational capability for those Marines relocated to Guam from Okinawa is 2022, and they're going to be finished in final operational capability in 2026. Separate from that, but related, is the replacement of Futenma Marine Corps Air Station on Okinawa. And the plan that has been strongly supported by the government of Japan has been to relocate that function, that operation, up to Camp Schwab at the northern part of Okinawa. There has been a lot of concern expressed by the governor of Okinawa and some of the citizens. However, the project being managed by the government of Japan is continuing. I would describe it as being in probably phase one, mostly planning and measurement and some early construction in the area where the intent is to have that runway, smaller runway, located. But it is an issue that we are keenly aware of. We're working very closely with folks in Japan. Our 3MEF commander and his staff are engaged. We're trying to transfer property from control by the Marine Corps on our bases that are located throughout Okinawa to the government of Okinawa as quickly as we can, consistent with the mission in that very active area.
Thank you. Another thing I'm concerned about is the lack of quality of life projects that we're seeing under the constrained budgets. What efforts are you taking to ensure that when the Marines move from Japan to Guam, that these types of facilities will be in place as they move to the island?
There's a lot of close coordination by Fleet Marine Forces Pacific, General Tulin and his staff, as well as with the Pacific Commander and his staff, Admiral Harris, to make sure that those projects are in fact lined up and ready to support the full Marine training mission when they do get to Guam. This involves everything from construction of a cantonment area, adding housing to Anderson Air Force Base, where those Marine families will be housed, the provision for firing ranges in the northern part of Guam, and a continuing effort to make sure that the construction timelines match the plan to actually move those Marine units.
Changing gears a bit, Master Chief Stevens told us last week that he was extremely concerned regarding the state of shore housing for sailors. Can you explain the current state of shore housing for sailors?
We have, as you know, a public-private venture that is managing our housing, and the level of satisfaction overall, there are always exceptions, but overall is extremely high. I've talked personally with Master Chief Stevens, and I think the primary concern that he is hearing from sailors in his travels is a potential for reduction of the BAH. If that is carried through and it's proposed that it be a 5% reduction, that would result in an overall $3.5 billion reduction in funding from BAH sources to the private contractors over the full life of the contracts that are currently in place. So we're looking at this very, very closely about how best to manage it. There are ongoing discussions with the contractors. One thing we want to make sure we avoid is taking the money out of the pockets of sailors and Marines and their families, and at the same time to make sure that there isn't a decrease in the quality of the housing that they are housed in from the contractor perspective.
I'd like to recognize myself for 5 minutes. I guess I'll start with Mr. McGinn. I want to talk a little bit about Okinawa. What's the current status of negotiations with the government of Japan and other countries such as Australia, Singapore, and the Philippines? And can you give the committee an update on the progress that has been made to date there? And then I also want to hear what you have to think, too, about, you know, what, in your view, constitutes an acceptable conclusion to the Fatemda replacement facility issue.
Given the complexity of those ongoing negotiations and all of the aspects, I'll respectfully request to take that question for the record and provide you a more comprehensive answer. It lies primarily in the responsibility of the folks in policy at the Office of the Secretary of Defense, as well as in our own Navy and Marine Corps policy shops, but I will consult with them and make sure we get you a good answer on that. Specifically to the Fatemda replacement, the construction activities are ongoing despite concerns by the governor of Okinawa, who I know has spoken with you. And we continue to make sure that whenever there's a possible interaction that can have a positive outcome related to the transfer of land from other bases back to Okinawa, we are doing that, as well as close coordination with the central government in Tokyo to make sure that the project is proceeding apace, considering the difference of opinion on, by the governor.
And, let me move to Ms. Hammack. By the end of fiscal year 2017, the Army is reducing the active component force structure to 450,000, I believe. Can you describe the impact of these force structure reductions, and what the impact will be across the Army on infrastructure requirements?
Thank you, Chairman Dent, for that question. One of the challenges is as we reduce force structure, it creates holes on bases. And in many of the bases where they might have four brigade combat teams, they go down to three, or they have three, they go down to two. That means there's empty barracks. That means there's empty company ops facilities.
More need for BRAC.
That means there's more need for a BRAC or a realignment and consolidation. And when there is that kind of capability on one of our major installations, that means we can move some smaller missions into that place and shut down an entire facility. And as Secretary Ballantyne said so well, that's where the real cost savings are.
Yeah, also, can you give some examples of installations or states that have the greatest challenges as the Army draws down the force, and you know, beginning in what fiscal year will the committee see military construction requirements for this decision, if any, that are needed?
As the company draws down the force, it certainly reduces the need for military construction. And that's why you see our budget right now, less of it is focused on replacing existing buildings, and more of it is focused on COCOM requirements and new missions. The challenge is, though, that the existing buildings become of poorer quality. So in the Army, we're seeing an increase in the number of poor and failing buildings every year, as we do not have the funding to sustain the facilities, and as we are questioning more where what the size of the Army is going to be in the future.
Quickly move to Ms. Ballantyne. The European Infrastructure Consolidation Study produced 8 consolidation opportunities for the Air Force. Can you walk the committee through the consolidation in the United Kingdom and give us an estimate of the costs associated with the consolidation and potential savings that will be achieved? So I just visited the UK and Groton, Molesworth, and got a sense of some of the issues that you're working on. I think the committee would like to learn a little bit more about it.
I'd be happy to, and I'll give you a little bit of an overview here, and if you'd like more detail, I'm happy to provide that for the record as well. So total costs across the entire continent are about $1.1 billion, and we anticipate around $275 to $300 million savings per year. In the UK specifically, we've got a number of actions that we're taking. So divesting from Alconbury and Molesworth, and those should save us about $75 million a year. Divesting from Mildenhall, which is the big muscle movement, I would say, as Mr. Patochny identified, and that is really that we're moving CV-22s and C-130Js to Spangdahlem, and moving KC-135 tankers to Ramstein. So all of those activities have begun. We do have some of the FY17 budget going towards executing those activities. I'll actually be visiting myself later on this spring, and we'll be able to get my eyes on. So, but if you'd like further detail than that, happy to provide it for the record.
Thank you. I'm going to quickly ask one more question, and I'll go back, right back to the ranking member. I'd like to also shift to Guam and the Mariana Islands. For the 17 budget includes about $81 million for Guam, Joint Region Marianas-Anderson. Are the mission requirements for Joint Region Marianas finalized and budgeted for in the out years? And if not, has the Air Force included a wedge of funding in the in future years' defense program to account for future military construction projects?
So we do spend a good portion of our MILCON on combatant commander requirements, and the shift to the Pacific is an important piece of that. Total in our 17 budget for PACOM is about $132 million. A good portion of that is going to Guam. We're hardening some facilities, building some C4I, which is command, control, communications, computers, and a number of other projects. And we do, of course, look across the FYDP in responding to our combatant commander's requests.
Mr. Bishop, I recognize you for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. This will relate to in strength and equipment drawdown. And Secretary Hammock, with the ongoing drawdown, can you describe for the committee what your biggest challenges are and how they will affect the Army's construction program?
Well, the biggest challenges in drawdown is that they create empty spaces. And so we are still maintaining money to operate a base that should be 100% full, and it might be 75% full or 50% full. So our base operating costs are the same, yet we've reduced the military manpower. When we consolidate in, we can optimize our infrastructure, we can reduce our costs, and then focus that funding on warfighter needs. And so the biggest concern as we're reducing end strength is we would like to manage our real estate in response to that. The Army has real estate left over from World War II when we were a force of 8.3 million. And now we're down to 450,000. We never got rid of all of that excess infrastructure, and we're whittling away at it a little bit every year. And as Mr. Patochny said, we've never reduced our infrastructure down to the 7% or even the 10% where we probably should operate. For the Army, in each round, we're taking out anywhere from 4 to 7% with an average of 5% each BRAC round. And that helps us, but that does get us where we need to be. And so technology has given us capabilities in the industrial base and in warfighting, where we have simulators that help our soldiers train better. We've consolidated with technologies, but we have not consolidated our footprint.
I see. Thank you. Secretary Ballantyne, what's been your biggest challenge with facilities as it pertains to the reduction of aircraft?
Well, likewise, reduction of aircraft and squadrons creates holes on our parkings and our parking pads and in our hangars and the like. So what you see across the Air Force is our squadron sizes are coming down. So rather than a squadron being 24 aircraft, you may see a squadron of 18 aircraft spread across more bases. So for each of those bases, you've got security forces that are protecting the bases, you've got gates that you got to keep open, you got finance people and human resources people. So if we can consolidate those squadrons into fewer bases, you can draw down all of that excess cost that we're spreading across, we're sort of peanut butter spreading, if you will, across our bases, not for optimal operational reasons, but simply to ensure that every base has a mission.
Where I come from, peanut butter spreading is a good thing.
Likewise in my household.
Thank you.
I just have one more question, and this I'll start with Mr. McGinn, but this will end up being for all of you. Mr. McGinn, in your statement, you mentioned that the Navy has taken on an initiative to standardize the facility inspection and facility condition index process. Please try to explain to the committee how you're achieving your goal and whether or not other services are following your lead. I'll let the other services respond to that, but if you want to just talk about how you're doing in the Navy.
Yes, sir. Starting about a year and a half ago, we took a look at how best to determine our facilities condition and to prioritize particular parts of those facilities. The simple example would be it's really important that the roof doesn't leak. So roofs are more important than appliances inside the building, walls, structure, and decking. And we wanted to make sure that as we looked across our whole installation infrastructure, that these priorities were being applied, so that we categorized our allocation of sustainability funds into fixing the most critical aspects. This has been something that has been briefed to our service chiefs and their staffs, and they're very and down through the chains of command. Everybody is very pleased with the fact that we are putting the money against the most critical projects.
Anybody else want to bite on this one? Ms. Hammack?
Certainly. The Army Corps of Engineers did a great job developing a program called Our Builder, which is the standardized inspection protocol. And it's a means to categorize what the requirements, what the needs are in the building. And as Secretary McGinn said, what kind of quality there is in the facilities. The biggest challenge the Army is facing is finding the funds to have the people to inspect to that building standard. And although we're addressing a small percentage of buildings every year, it will take us quite some time to fully inspect and categorize all of our properties to that standard.
Ms. Ballantyne?
So I'd like to get with my experts and come back to you with the details, but I will say that, as you know, the Air Force has just recently stood up the Installation Mission Support Center. My two counterparts here have had centralized management of installation mission support for quite some time, and the Air Force has launched this program in the last couple of years. And the real beauty and opportunity of this type of construct is that it allows us to take an enterprise-wide look at things like facilities, so that we won't be just taking a look base by base by base, command by command by command, and not necessarily getting after, from an enterprise perspective, the most important mission critical worst first. So that's really the beauty of our new Installation Mission Support Center.
Thank you.
Sir, if I could just add, excuse me, to that. So what I think you just heard was is we have some pretty good standards there, and we're working pretty hard at even making them better.
so that we can spend the money that you're providing to us against the facilities essentially that are worse first, but we still have too many of them to be spending money on, and that's the current theme. So we are being good stewards of what we're getting here with a systematic approach, but the inventory of buildings that we're taking care of just is simply too much.
Well, thank you all. We appreciate all of you being here today and providing, you know, comprehensive testimony, and we may have some additional questions for the record. And I know there are some that you want to get back to us on, which is fine. We have a vote as we speak, and so timing is good. So again, I want to thank you all for joining us today. I hope that we'll be moving to a markup on this Milcon VA bill the week of March 22nd, we hope. That's aspirational, I think, at this point, but that's the hope. So that said, the hearing's adjourned.
Thank you.